Father, certainly today we give you thanks for another day. You saw fit to allow us to have air in our lungs and strengthen our bones and our muscles to get out of bed, to come to this place to get to know you better. First of all, thank you for your grace and your mercy. Your word clearly says they're new every morning. So we want to pause and tell you thanks. Secondly, we want to pray that your spirit now would take me over. I would decrease, that you would increase, that you would be our Bible teacher today. We, as a group of people, want to get to know you better. We want to jump up into your lap, hear from our Heavenly Father how much you love us, how to do this life that is very confusing at times, and to have hope. I think, Lord, a lot of times you are wanting to speak to us, and we try to kind of shuffle our way out of it, but now we're right here. You have our attention. So now I pray you would speak to us now by the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. By a show of hands, I want to ask you a question. How many of us in here, in this group right now, wake up in the morning with the help of an alarm clock? Can I see a show of hands? Okay, now look around. Look around and see. Okay, very good. All right, hands out. How many of us in here wake up in the morning with mom and dad maybe coming and rubbing your back a little bit and saying, come on, it's time to wake up, honey, right? Okay, yeah, see, we got that. Yeah, I do that with my boys. I'll come in there, it's time to wake up. I'll just kind of nice and lovingly, you know, hey, guys, you know, time to get up. Yeah, some of you teens, I see you in the back. Yeah, I see you. Our Bible teacher last week, and a good friend of mine, Steve Williams, you know how he wakes up his wife in the morning? He plays this song, and it's called, Good Morning, Good Morning Love. I mean, he like ushers her into the morning, you know, it's just nice and smooth. And if you know Steve, like, he's a big wrestler kind of guy. Dude's like romantic and just smooth, you know. That's why I'm trying to take lessons from him. You know, I told you I was taking salsa lessons from him. All different ways that we as human beings get out of bed. We're sleeping. We need to be woken up. Now, in the same way, many of us are spiritually sleeping. And God will many times try to wake us up spiritually with that nice rub on the back. Hey, I'm here. Let's wake up. Let's do life together. Get away. That was me, my life. God was trying to rub my back. Come on, buddy, wake up spiritually. I got a great plan for you. Right? Maybe sometimes he kind of comes to you, sings a song to you. Good, you know, you're in worship today. You're kind of, oh, this is kind of, but that's like Christianity. That's kind of nerdy stuff. No, get away from you, God. Unfortunately, for most of us in here, you know how we got woken up spiritually by God? It was an alarm clock. And I don't know about you, but like this morning, that was me. I got woken up by my alarm clock, 5 a.m., going to the gym. And what the first thing I did? I hit snooze. Dying over here. And my alarm clock is one of those escalating alarm clocks. You guys have that one, you know, where it starts off kind of and then it goes, you hit it. Now, some of you in here, and I used to have this, that old school one. Remember that old school alarm clock? Anybody have that one right now? Yeah, see, those of you guys that really have a hard time waking up. Now, unfortunately, and I would say the bulk of us in here have had to be woken up by God spiritually with that annoying alarm clock. Now, what does that look like? Some of you guys in here have God's got your attention through the spiritual alarm clock of a loss of a loved one, through death or divorce or disease. Some of you, you've gotten woken up by a loss of a job, a career, a business, if you will. That was God's alarm clock in your life to grab your attention finally. Some of you maybe fought cancer or some other disease. There's been ways that God has tried to get your attention. And he tried for a long time, as was in the case of my life. He tried. It was okay. It was the escalating alarm clock until finally God broke me. Mine, as I've shared in the past, was a loss of a job, physical ailment, a tearing of a hamstring, a complete dismantling of my earthly dream. So God finally had me on my back, and the only place I could do was look up. That was my spiritual alarm clock. C.S. Lewis writes that pain is God's megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Let me say that again. Pain and trial and tribulation is God's megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Many times we have to hit rock bottom till we're looking straight up where God can get our attention. In this book, 21 Reasons Bad Things Happen to Good People by Dave Early, he talks about how Chuck Colson and how God got his attention. I want to read just a little brief snippet. In fact, pick one of these up for you guys that are going through a trial or you have some questions about why did God allow bad things to happen to good people? I want you to pick this book up. It's powerful. It's a Bible study, basically, that tells you about that. Let me read this to you. Chuck Colson, okay? At the age of 38, Chuck Colson arrogantly thought he had arrived. He had it all, and he didn't need God. As the chief counsel to the President of the United States, he wielded incredible power and had an ego to match. Thinking they could do no wrong, Richard Nixon's hatchet man, Colson, among others, hatched a plan to steal secrets from their party's opposition. Colson's big balloon burst as he and his cronies found themselves in a terrifying nightmare. Played out daily in the media was the sickening news of the dishonesty and petty political dirty tricks played by the Watergate 7. Caught in the ugly web of the Watergate political scandal, his world crashed down around him as he found himself facing public scorn and ridicule, the loss of his lofty position, see, and a prison term. Holmes gets sent to jail. This was the unbearably deepest, darkest time of his life. His dreams were shattered. Sound familiar? His immense pride was broken. And I underline this. He was at the bottom and had nowhere else to look up. And this is what he says, Chuck Colson. This is him quoting right here. I was crying so hard, it was like I was swimming underwater. Then I prayed my first real prayer. God, I don't know how to find you, but I'm going to try. I'm not much the way I am, but somehow I want to give myself to you. I didn't know how to say it, so I repeated over and over the words, take me. Boy, that was my story. In my truck, dreams shattered, flat on my back. Finally, the alarm clock, I stopped pushing snooze, and I finally got out of bed. And I praise God for that. That was 1997. What are we in now? 09. 12 years walking in this love relationship with God. That's been a walk by faith, an amazing journey. Maybe God has tried to get your attention in the past, and you've maybe hit the snooze button. You've ignored it. Is he trying to get your attention again? Is the alarm clock going off again? You see, he has a reason for this tragedy, this trial in your life. And it's similar to when you have a child with a splinter. You guys have gone through this situation. I've done this with Blaze. Blaze ran his toe. We were down at the Lake of the Ozarks, and there's kind of wood, kind of dock, and got a splinter in there, and just freaked out. And this hurts so bad. And I'm like, dude, you know, like, come to Dad. You know, I'll be able to take care of it. No, no, no. He's running around. No. Hey, I'm right here. I got the tweezers, a little alcohol, be able to take care of it. No, no.